Hey crazies, we're gonna cover some big questions today. Is the universe really infinite? Does it have an edge? How can it be flat? And what's up with this mole on my- Okay, maybe not that last one. Before we even try to answer these, we're gonna need to clarify some things. First, the word universe can mean a bunch of different things. Merriam-Webster says the scientific definition is all of space and everything in it, including stars, planets, galaxies, etc. But when most people refer to the universe, they're only talking about the stuff that we can see. That's what astronomers call the observable universe, and it's definitely not infinite. In every direction, we see a blotchy shell of hydrogen atoms completely enclosing us. The light from those atoms is called the cosmic microwave background, or CMB, and it's coming from a distance of about 13.8 billion light years away. So you might be inclined to say the observable universe is 27.6 billion light years across. But the speed of light is finite, so the farther out we look, the further back in time we look. If this was emitted from 13.8 billion light years away, then it was emitted from there 13.8 billion years ago. So it gives us a decent estimate of the age of the observable universe, but not its size. Just stop and think about this for a minute. What you're looking at is the formation of the first ever hydrogen atoms. This is what the whole observable universe looked like 13.8 billion years ago. Okay. So to get the current size, we need to adjust for the time difference. Space has expanded since that light was emitted, so the edge is now 46.5 billion light years away, meaning the observable universe is 93 billion light years across. Very big, but still finite. However, the observable universe is probably not the entire universe. Everything we're capable of observing must be within our past light cone. The rest is behind a cloak of invisibility known as the cosmic horizon. Since that horizon grows over time, you'd expect it to reveal more things to us. Unfortunately, the universe seems to be accelerating in its expansion. So the galaxies are moving farther apart faster than the cosmic horizon grows. The observable universe is getting lonelier as time goes on. But what about the entire universe? Is that infinite? Well, that depends on a few things. We're going deep. Since we can't measure anything beyond the cosmic horizon, we're gonna have to be a little more creative with the stuff inside it. Two things will help with this: curvature and topology. Basically, we need to know both local and global properties. And since local stuff is easier to understand, we'll start with curvature. How local? Infinitesimally local. Considering the scale of the observable universe, you might think this box is pretty local, but that's far too big for fundamental physics. So then you might make the box smaller, like this. Not small enough. If there's any kind of real size to that box, all you'll ever see is an average curvature. And you all know how I feel about averages. It's a number that only exists on paper. It has no physical meaning. What we need is an infinitesimal box, a size that's infinitely small, yet still not zero. When it comes to representing curvature, those infinitesimals come packaged in something we call a metric, and each metric can be written in a wide variety of coordinates. Let me just show you. If you want to take space-time and divide it into infinitesimal pieces, those pieces will have four dimensions, three for space and one for time. A different choice of coordinates can change the shape of those pieces, but curvature can change their shape and size. A metric puts all of that information in one place, and it gives us everything we need to develop concepts about length, distance, volume, or even the passage of time. This is what we need to understand what the universe looks like. Just keep in mind, these pieces aren't necessarily real physical pieces. They're just imaginary pieces that help us write equations. Speaking of which, behold! The Friedman-Lemaître-Robertson-Walker metric, or FLRW metric for short. Yes, there's a lot going on here, so let's try to make better sense of it. We could actually write it as simple as this, where this A is called the scale factor, representing the universe's expansion. So basically, this tells us that space expands, but time doesn't. If we wanted to get a little more information out of it, we could write it like this, which tells us the overall curvature of space-time is inward and outward. That means the universe is spherically symmetric, or isotropic. But a better way to put that is that it looks the same in all directions. So what does this mean for the size of the universe? I'm getting there, okay? The size of the universe hinges on wherever this k falls on the number line. If it's exactly zero, the universe is called flat. Side note! Flat doesn't mean flat like a piece of paper. It just means that any shape in any slice of space-time has the same properties as that shape in a flat piece of paper. The universe is most definitely not a piece of paper. End of side note. The easiest shape to consider is a triangle. Angles in a flat triangle add to be exactly 180 degrees. So that's what they'll do in a flat spacetime. If the K is positive, though, angles in a triangle will add to be more than 180 degrees. The universe could have sphere, ellipsoid, or even donut-shaped slices. If the K is negative, angles in a triangle will add to be less than 180 degrees. Slices could be shaped like a hyperboloid. So what does this mean for the size of the universe? All right. If the universe has positive curvature, it cannot be infinite. It must curve back on itself and be finite with no edges. If the universe is flat or has negative curvature, it could be finite or infinite. It depends. On topology. We mentioned earlier that a sphere and a donut have the same type of curvature, positive curvature. But they don't have the same topology because of this giant gaping hole. To know the shape of the universe completely, we need to know its topology. This is where things get super tricky. We can only take measurements in our observable part of the universe, so it might be impossible to measure topology. But we can definitely measure curvature. And if the universe has positive curvature, we know that it's finite regardless of its topology. We can draw a triangle, measure the angles, add them up, and we get exactly 180 degrees. I refuse to accept the universe is flat. We're gonna need a bigger triangle. Let's use the CMB from earlier. The Earth can be one corner. Then we'll pick the other two corners to be in the hydrogen emitting the CMB. We know the lengths of all the sides, so we can get the angles too. Yeah, trig! Adding up the angles, we get exactly 180 degrees. Okay, using an unimaginable amount of data collected from the Planck Space Telescope, we see that the universe is pretty flat. That doesn't necessarily mean the universe is infinite, though. This is an example of a flat, finite universe. It's kind of like a soccer ball with flat faces. But most cosmologists don't get behind topologies like that. This is one of those places where Occam's razor becomes important, which says, when presented with two competing hypotheses explaining an observation, you should err on the side of caution and start with the one with the fewest assumptions. In other words, start with the simplest one. So while this soccer ball shape might be possible, it is most definitely not simple. Cosmologists stick to what they call trivial solutions, which means simple shapes with no edges. In which case, a flat universe must be infinite. The Planck Space Telescope isn't perfect, though. There's still a 0.4% margin of error. There still could be some curvature to the overall universe, as long as it's unimaginably larger than the observable part. I'm still holding out for that finite universe with positive curvature.
But just because your universe is finite in size doesn't mean that it's totally finite. Physics still needs a lot of infinity to support it. I'll explain why getting Archimedes from A to B requires you to assume that there are way more numbers in this distance than you might have imagined.
That sounds interesting. You should check that out. All right, crazies, that's it for today. Thanks for liking and sharing this video. Don't forget to subscribe if you'd like to keep up with us. And until next time, remember, it's okay to be a little crazy. In the last video, we learned about how far apart things are in space. Comment response time! Antares was impressed that the moon is so far away but could still affect the tides. Yeah, I know, right? How crazy is that? In all fairness, though, it's not the only reason the tides happen. The oceans also need a lot of fluid pressure, so it helps that they're all connected to each other. While the moon is the primary cause of the tides, it is not the only reason they happen. Kahandrin guessed that if we wanted to place the next closest star in our scale model, it would probably have to be in space. And indeed it would. A little over 4 light-years away, there's this star system with 3 stars in it. The closest of the three is a little red dwarf known as Proxima Centauri. And on our scale, it would be the size of a small car, but located twice as far as the real actual moon. That Mr. TC wants faster than light travel, but says that Einstein is standing in the way with a barbed wire baseball bat. A barbed wire baseball bat? Really? Einstein is German, and he's smart, so obviously he would be using a two-handed longsword known as a Zweihänder. Also, the Alcubierre drive might be a way to outmaneuver him. Alexandra Ochoa wants the moon to be closer. I don't think that's such a good idea. If the moon were as close as most people think, it would orbit the Earth every 8.3 hours. And as Thomas Jackson said, we have a hard time keeping satellites in orbit. Also, I'm not sure how that would affect the tides. Elliot Gray brought up the game Majora's Mask, and honestly, it kept popping into my head the whole time I was editing. He wondered what would happen if the moon crashed into the Earth. If it came in fast enough, it could stay in one piece. But the moon in Majora's Mask took days to come down. That's plenty of time for gravitational tidal forces to break up the moon, probably turning it into a big ring around the Earth. Well, until the pieces finally came crashing down. You can science it pointed out that the moon reflector isn't just for NASA. If you have a strong enough signal, you can use it too. It's a retro reflector, so it returns the light back to exactly where it came from, no matter what angle you're at. Anyway, crazies, thanks for watching, and don't forget to check out Looking Glass Universe. See you next time!